Post-exposure prophylaxis. Objectives. This video shows various sharps being generated.
Occurrence of occupational exposure of healthcare workers to some blood-borne viral pathogens. For example, HIV, hepatitis B virus and hepatitis C virus.
Ways of minimizing or preventing such exposures. Need for prompt institution of post-exposure prophylaxis or PEP after such exposure. Sharps being generated in any healthcare setting are of various types. An exposure that may place healthcare professional at risk of blood-borne pathogens is defined as a percutaneous injury, for example, needle stick or cut with a sharp instrument, contact with the mucous membrane of the eye or mouth, contact with non-intact skin, particularly when exposed skin is chapped, abraded, or afflicted with dermatitis, or contact with the intact skin when the contact duration is prolonged, for example, several minutes or more, with blood or other potentially infectious body fluids.
According to WHO estimate, in the year 2003, sharp injuries resulted in 16,000 hepatitis C virus, 66,000 hepatitis B virus, and 200 to 5,000 HIV infections in healthcare workers worldwide.
Risk of infection due to sharp injuries. Percutaneous exposure based on CDC statistics. HBV virus, the risk was 9 to 30%. HCV, 3 to 10% risk. And HIV, 0.25 to 0.3% risk. Potentially infectious body fluids include blood, blood products, all body fluids, pleural fluid, pericardial fluid, peritoneal fluid, semen, vaginal secretions. The following are not considered potentially infectious unless visibly contaminated with blood: feces, nasal secretions, saliva, sputum, sweat, tears, urine, and vomitus. Transmission through intact skin has not been documented. Factors that influence risk of infection are type of needle, hollow bore versus solid, device visibly contaminated with patient's blood, depth of injury, the amount of blood involved in the exposure, the amount of virus or viral load in the exposed body or body fluid at the time of exposure, timely availability and efficacy of PEP. Practices that reduce risk of exposure. Prevention of exposure to the virus remains the mainstay of occupational infection prevention. Some simple procedures can limit the risk of infection to HCPs. Guidelines formulated or published by the CDC, known as the standard precautions, should be followed for handling blood and body fluids, including all secretions and excretions, by the HCPs at all times. The essentials of standard precautions and safe laboratory practices. Blood, blood products, all body fluids, and materials contaminated with them are considered as infectious for HIV, HBV, HCV, and other blood-borne pathogens. Use appropriate barrier precautions to prevent exposure to skin and mucous membranes. Wear gloves, gowns or aprons, masks, and goggles while handling all potentially infectious material. Take special care of handling sharp objects like needles, lancets, scalpels, etc. to avoid injuries. Avoid unnecessary use of sharps and needles. Disposable needles should be used. Handle hollow bore needles with care as it may lead to deep injuries. Never recap needles. Never break bent needles by hand. Needles or sharps should not be left on trolleys and bedside tables and must be disposed of immediately. Never pass used sharps from one person to another directly. Dispose sharps in a puncture-resistant container Thoroughly wash hands with water and soap after removing gloves, handling infectious materials before leaving the laboratory area, and immediately after any contamination of skin surfaces. Work surfaces should be decontaminated with 0.1% sodium hypochlorite solution. Laboratory personnel should refrain from mouth pipetting, eating, drinking, or smoking in the work area. Access to the laboratory should be limited to trained personnel only. Food and drink must be stored in refrigerators in areas other than the work area. All healthcare professionals must be immunized against HPV. Steps for post-exposure management. These are the steps to be followed after accidental exposure to blood or other potentially infectious materials. 1. First aid. 2. Risk assessment. 3. Informed consent and counseling. 4. Decision on prophylactic treatment for HIV and HPV. 5. Monitoring and follow-up of HIV, HPV and HCV status. 6. Documentation and recording of exposure. 1. First aid. A. Management of exposed site for skin. If the skin is broken after a needle stick or sharp instrument, immediately wash the wound and surrounding skin with water and soap and rinse. Do not scrub. Do not use antiseptics or skin washes, for example, bleach, chlorine, or alcohol. B. For the eye. Immediately irrigate the exposed eye thoroughly with water or normal saline. If wearing contact lenses, leave them in place while irrigating. Once the eye is cleaned, remove the contact lenses and clean them in a normal manner. Do not use soap or disinfectant on the eye. C. For mouth. Spit fluid out immediately. Rinse the mouth thoroughly using water or saline and spit again. Repeat the process several times. Do not use soap or disinfectant in the mouth. The exposure must be reported immediately to the concerned authority so that, if required, prophylaxis can be started as soon as possible. Consult the nearest resource or ART center for PEP, evaluation and follow-up as per the national guidelines on PEP. Assessment of infection risk. A designated person or trained doctor must assess the risk of HIV and HPV transmission following an accidental exposure to blood, or the AEB. This assessment must be quick so as to start treatment or prophylaxis without delay. Assessing the nature of exposure. Three categories are described based on the amount of blood or body fluid and the entry port. These categories are intended to help in assessing the severity of the exposure, but may not cover all the possibilities. Category: mild exposure. Definition and example: mucous membrane or non-intact skin with small volume. For example, a superficial wound, that is erosion of the epidermis, with a plain or low caliber needle, contact with the eyes or mucous membrane, subcutaneous injuries following a small bore needle. Moderate exposure. Definition and example: mucous membrane or non-intact skin with large volumes or percutaneous superficial exposure with solid needle. For example, a cut or needle stick injury, penetrating gloves. Severe exposure. Definition and example: percutaneous with large volume, for example, an accident with white bore needle, visibly contaminated with blood, a deep wound, hemorrhagic wound and or very painful, transmission of a significant volume of blood, an accidental injury with material which has been previously used intravenously or intra-arterially. Assessing the HIV status of the source of exposure. Evaluation of the source. If the HIV status of the source person is known and confirmed as negative, PEP is not required. If the status of the patient is unknown and neither the patient nor his or her blood is available for testing, then the choice of whether to use PEP and what regimen will depend on the severity of the wound and how much is known about the individual's HIV risk history. If the status of the patient is unknown and the patient is available, he is to be counseled and consent obtained for testing. If the patient refuses testing but a sample of blood is available, it is the right of the exposed person that the blood sample be tested, but the source patient may decline to be informed of the result. If the patient has refused counseling and testing and there is no blood sample available, it is the right of the exposed person to ask that blood be taken for testing and the source patient may decline to be informed of the result. Under no circumstances should the source patient be charged for the test. If the patient is known to be HIV positive, evaluation of risk is in order. Two key factors to consider are antiretroviral drug naive, whether he or she is on ARTs, and whether the patient is likely to have a high viral load as determined by testing, if available, or by clinical signs and symptoms. Low risk, asymptomatic or viral load is less than 400 copies per ml. High risk, symptomatic with OI or AIDS, acute seroconversion, high viral load. In the case of a high-risk exposure from a source patient on ARTs, consult an expert to choose appropriate PEP regimen if drug resistance is high. HIV status of the source, HIV negative, definition of risk in source, source is not HIV infected, but consider HBV and HCV. Low risk, definition of risk in source, HIV positive and clinically asymptomatic. High risk, definition of risk in source, HIV positive and clinically symptomatic. If the HIV status of the source is unknown, definition risk in source, status of the patient is unknown and neither the patient nor his or her blood is available for testing. Informed consent and counseling. Almost every person feels anxious after exposure. They should be counseled and psychological support provided. They should be informed about the PEP. Exposed persons should receive appropriate information about the risks and benefits of PEP medications. It should be clear that PEP is not mandatory. Exposed persons should, however, be made to understand that a few cases of transmission have been seen in cases given by prophylaxis. Documentation of exposure is essential. For prophylactic treatment, the exposed person must sign a consent form. Informed consent also means that if exposed, the person has been advised on PEP. If the individual refuses to initiate PEP, it should be documented. The designated officer for PEP should keep this document. An information sheet covering the PEP and the biological follow-up after any AEB must be given to the person under treatment. Decision on PEP medications or regimen. Because PEP has its greatest effect if started within 2 hours of exposure, it is essential to act immediately. Ideally, therapy should be started within 2 hours and definitely within 72 hours of exposure. Never delay starting therapy due to uncertainty. Reevaluation of the exposed person should be considered within 72 hours post-exposure, especially if additional information about the exposure or source person becomes available. If the risk is insignificant, PEP could be discontinued if already started. Exposed individuals who are known or discovered to be HIV positive should not receive PEP.
The basic thing that needs to be understood is that any suspected HIV exposure through needle, the answer lies in PEP and within 72 hours or 3 days. That's the main thing.
The decision to start this type of regimen depends on the type of exposure and the HIV status of the source person mentioned earlier. Dosages of the drugs for PEP for adults and adolescents. fixed dose combination, FDC, of tenofovir, that is TDF, 300 mg plus lamivudine, 3 TC, 300 mg plus efavirenz, EFV, 600 mg, once daily for 4 weeks. If the source is already on ART, start the exposed person with the above-mentioned regimen at the earliest with proper counseling and then refer for an expert opinion. Seek an expert opinion in case of delay in reporting exposure more than 72 hours, unknown source, known or suspected pregnancy but initiate PEP, breastfeeding mothers but initiate PEP, source patient is on ARTs, major toxicity of PEP. While the source patient is on ART, the physician should consider the comparative risk represented by the exposure, taking into account the source's history of and response to ARTs based on clinical response, CD4 cell count, viral load measurements if available, and current disease stage. If the source person's virus is known or suspected to be resistant to one or more drugs considered for PEP regimen, then the exposed person needs to be given alternate PEP drug regimen and referred for expert opinion. Pregnancy and PEP. If the concerned healthcare professional is pregnant at the time of occupational exposure to HIV, she should get regimen for primary management of the exposure like non-pregnant persons. Pregnant women who sustain occupational exposure should also be offered antiretroviral chemoprophylaxis if required. The designated authority of physician must be consulted about the use of ARTs for post-exposure management. For a female healthcare professional, considering PEP, pregnancy test is recommended in case of a doubt. Side effects and adherence to PEP. Studies have indicated more side effects, most commonly nausea and fatigue among healthcare professionals taking PEP than PLHAs taking ARTs. These side effects occur mainly at the beginning of the treatment and include nausea, diarrhea, muscular pain, and headache. The person taking the treatment should be informed that these may occur and should be dissuaded from stopping the treatment as most side effects are mild and transient, though possibly uncomfortable. Anemia and/or leukopenia and/or thrombocytopenia may occur during the month of treatment. Adherence information and psychological support are essential. More than 95% adherence is important to maximize the efficacy of the medication in PEP. Side effects can be reduced through medications. A complete blood count and liver function test may be performed at the beginning of the treatment and after 4 weeks. Post-exposure prophylaxis against HBV and HCV. Post-exposure prophylaxis regimens against HBV depend upon the HBV status of the source, type of exposure, and previous immunization status of the exposed person. Management of individuals exposed to HBV and HCV. There is no PEP regimen recommended for HCV. However, there are specific steps that can be taken to reduce the risk of infection for those exposed to HBV. Post-exposure prophylaxis for HBV. A person's response to HBV exposure depends on his or her immune status, as determined by the history of hepatitis B vaccination and vaccine response if tested 1 to 2 months after vaccination, and whether the exposure poses a risk of infection. HBV-PEP is safe for women who are pregnant or breastfeeding. Monitoring and follow-up of HIV, HBV and HCV status. Follow-up of exposed healthcare professionals. Long-term follow-up, counseling and education. Testing for at least 6 months after exposure, that is 6 weeks, 12 weeks and 6 months. If PEP is used, drug toxicity monitoring at baseline and after 2 weeks. HPV immune status. Unvaccinated, post-exposure prophylaxis, HBV vaccination, and HBIG. Previously vaccinated, known responder, anti-hepatitis B surface antigen positive, post-exposure prophylaxis, none. Previously vaccinated, known non-responder, HPV vaccination, and HBIG. Antibody response unknown. Test if any antibody response is less than 10 international units per ml. Post-exposure prophylaxis, HPV vaccination, and HBIG. The person should be provided with pretest counseling and PEP should be started as discussed. Before starting PEP, 3 to 5 ml of the person's baseline blood sample is to be taken and sent to the laboratory for testing and storage. It is important that a serum sample is collected from the healthcare professional as soon as possible at 0 hour after exposure for HIV testing. Otherwise, it may be difficult to attribute the infection acquired due to exposure in the occupational setting. This may have a bearing on the claims for compensation from the health authorities. The first sample for HIV testing is collected immediately after exposure, the second at 6 weeks, the third at 12 weeks, and the last at 6 months after exposure. During the follow-up period, especially the first 6 to 12 weeks, the following measures are to be adopted by the healthcare professional. Refraining from blood, semen, organ donation, and abstinence from sexual intercourse. In case sexual intercourse is undertaken, a latex condom must be used to reduce the risk of HIV transmission. Women should not breastfeed their infants. The exposed person is advised to seek medical evaluation for any febrile illness that occurs within 12 weeks of exposure. Timing, baseline, month 3, month 6, tests done irrespective of PEP intake. HIV, anti-HCV, and HBsAg. Documentation and recording of exposure. The exposure report details should include date, time, and place of exposure, type of procedure done, type of exposure, that is, percutaneous, mucous membrane, etc., duration of exposure, exposure source and volume, type of specimen involved. All persons at risk must be informed of the importance of immediate exposure reporting to ensure preventive care can be initiated in time to be effective and to remember that a casual approach leads to casualty. Occupational exposure and rights of the exposed persons. If transmission of a bloodborne infection occurs after occupational exposure has been documented, the healthcare professional has a right to receive treatment and care for this illness. It is also the right of all infected patients to be free from discrimination at their workplace. Such patients are entitled to have all their human rights respected, beginning firstly with the right to confidentiality regarding their healthcare. Do's and don'ts for the exposed individual. Don'ts. Do not panic. Do not place the pricked finger into the mouth reflexively. Do not squeeze blood from the wound. Do not use bleach, alcohol, iodine, antiseptic, detergent, etc. Do's. Stay calm. Remove glove if appropriate. Wash exposed site thoroughly with running water and soap. Irrigate thoroughly with water if splashes have gone into the eyes or mouth. Consult the designated physician or personnel immediately as per institutional guidelines for management of the occupational exposure.